Hello, lovely internet strangers. In this video, I will continue discussing The Fraud of Feminism by Ernest Belfort Bax, published in 1913, which is the first book I am discussing as part of the anti-feminist canon. So this video will contain all the things that I wanted to talk about that would not fit into the previous video. And once again, I'm speaking in present tense about the author's time period in the early 1900s. So he discusses anti-man legislation, particularly pertaining to marriage. He was a barrister, and that was an area of expertise for him. One law he discusses relates to breach of promise, that is, a woman can punish a man for refusing to marry her after they have been engaged, even if the man has grounds to terminate the engagement. Technically, a man has the right to do the same, but that right isn't enforced, and women are not convicted of perjury. Quote, however gross the misrepresentations or undue influences on the part of the woman may have been to induce the man to marry her, they do not cause her to lose her right to compensation. In the past, women used to need to cohabitate with a man and treat him with decency, but now that doesn't matter. A man will likely go to jail and have his property taken away. Quote, the law imposes upon the wife no legally enforceable duties whatever towards her husband. The one thing which it will enforce with iron vigor is the wife's right of maintenance against her husband. Bax says for men, the process for divorce is costly, whereas the wife can just go to the police court and whine and get a separation, and the husband has to advance his wife money to fight him in divorce court. He wrote more extensively about this in a pamphlet called The Legal Subjection of Men. Feminists will claim that the marriage law is unjust for women because they have to prove adultery and cruelty, while men only have to prove adultery. But Bax essentially says that if they had two brain cells to rub together, they would know that the law exists because woman's adultery could result in a bastard child, and her husband would now be responsible for that child, while a man's adultery cannot affect a woman's life and property. I assume this is because rules for child support for children born out of wedlock were not the same that they are today. And Bax says that marriage law is always framed as an injustice toward a woman, and the discussion is about giving relief to the wife who's with a horrible husband, but the idea that the reverse could happen is totally out of the question. Quote, that that reviled and despised thing, a husband, may also have reason to desire relief from a wife whose angelic qualities and vast superiority to his own vile male self he fails to appreciate never seems to enter into the calculation at all. There are some great quotes in this book, I'm not gonna lie. And he says, misconduct or neglect by the wife does not free the husband from his obligation to take care of her, but neglect on his part gets her legal separation with alimony, etc., etc. Violence by the husband toward the wife was seriously punished, but the woman would be let off with impunity if she was violent toward her husband. And even if she was imprisoned, the husband was compelled to take her back or at least support her. For example, he references a case where a wife nearly murdered her husband and he still had to support her. Bax says that the same law exists for both sexes, but the inequality is largely in the administration and application of the law, that the evidence to convict a woman of murder has to be much stronger than evidence needed to put a man to death, and even if she's convicted, the woman will be spared the death penalty. He says there used to be a theory that if a jury of men found the female defendant innocent, it was because she was pretty, and he says that used to be true, but now that feminist views are so dominant, it doesn't matter if she's pretty, she just has to be a woman. Bax actually challenged a male feminist friend to find a court case where the man was favored at the expense of a woman. The only case this man could find was a case where the man who had not committed an offense was acquitted, while his female companion, who had in fact committed a crime, was punished, and his friend said that this showed the court bias in favor of the man. So Bax uses this as an illustration of how, quote, otherwise judicial minds could be hypnotized by feminist dogma. One law he brings up and discusses at length is the White Slave Trade Act of 1912, also known as the Criminal Law Amendment Act of 1912. This was in the UK. I won't go into too much detail here, but it had to do with prostitution, basically punishing any man involved in any way with a prostitute. Bax says this was rushed through legislature because of public excitement organized for that purpose, that it was backed up by the usual fake statements, and it gives increased powers to the police to arrest on suspicion, and it includes flogging clauses, and flogging used to be reserved for violent crimes, but now flogging can be applied to non-violent offenses. But only men get flogged, even though there are way more women involved in prostitution. And prostitution isn't actually a crime, immoral but not illegal, but the law makes it illegal for a prostitute to give some of her property to a male friend. He would become a criminal. And Bax says that many employers pay women lower wages on the assumption that they're supplementing their wages with prostitution. Again, I'm speaking in present tense from 1913. I don't think employers today are paying women lower wages on the assumption that they're supplementing their wages with prostitution, although that would be an interesting argument for the feminists to make to explain the wage gap, now wouldn't it? Bax notes the idea of a woman's charter that was proposed by a lady Malarin Aberconway, who suggested that a husband should be legally compelled to pay a certain amount of money to his wife, presumably as wages for housekeeping, no matter whether she performs the services well or at all. And no matter what the woman does, the husband has to pay her all the same. Also, that a wife should be under no obligation to follow her husband to any place of residence outside the British Isles. She also proposed to raise the age of consent, which would then increase the number of victims. Also, that if a woman murdered her child, that the father should be punished as an accessory. Wow! Bax brings up the rule of the sea, the idea that all women have the right to be rescued before a single man, for example, on the Titanic. Bax calls that sex favoritism and says it has nothing to do with physical strength. He says, quote, "A number of poor wretches are doomed to a watery grave simply and solely because they have not had the luck to be born of the privileged female sex." I mentioned in the previous video about differences between men and women in terms of men having muscular strength and women having constitutional strength, but Bax goes into it in some detail, discussing men having a greater mortality rate, that 120 boys to every 100 girls die under the age of 5. I don't know the exact statistics, but I do know that the death ratio is still unequal, that more men die than women on a group average. Bax said that violence and accidents cause 150% more deaths among men than women, possibly because men put themselves in that situation more often, but possibly because they have a weaker constitution, and that between the ages of 55 and 65, there are significantly more deaths among men, and women die less of diseases, so they therefore have a greater power to resist them. Bax says that the success of the feminist movement depends largely on men's apathy, that most men don't sympathize with the movement, but they are indifferent to it. They don't take it seriously, which is a mistake. The idea of women being dangerous to men is absurd to them, and Bax says, quote, "They do not realize that the question is not the physical strength of women as women, but of the whole forces of the state being at the disposal of women to set in motion to gratify their whims and passions," which is still as true today as it was in 1913, if you ask me. He also says that modern feminism is not just about respecting ideal womanhood, but about placing on a pedestal the mere fact of femalehood in general. So it doesn't matter what the quality of your character is, you're a woman, it's fine. He also points out that feminists, in Britain at least, were zealous in championing a puritanical view of sexual morality, and that when women got the vote, he predicted they would enforce asceticism on men through the law, that any forms of indulgence by men, sexual or otherwise, would be criminalized. And he says, you can see the evidence of this by reading the suffragette papers and other feminist writings. Bax says that the press plays a huge role in promoting the feminist movement, that almost any journal is ready to publish any argument in favor of suffrage or the other claims of the movement on behalf of women, but feminists will still whine at being boycotted. This is even more true today, not just in the press in terms of journalism, but in terms of publishing in general. The number of feminist books that get published every year is crazy, and they'll still say they have to fight for feminism. But what are they fighting? They can publish feminist books all they want. Doesn't mean anyone has to read their bullshit. Bax says that the modern women's movement is based at least partly on an assumption that he says is unfounded, which is that man has systematically oppressed women in the past, and that the natural tendency of man is that he's evil-minded and he always wants to oppress women, or that woman is the victim of the man's ego. He says that if you're a student of history, anthropology, physiology, you should see that this is not a sound view, and that the feminist sees evidence of male oppression in the place woman occupies in social and political life, rather than it being the natural consequence of her biological makeup, i.e. her secondary sexual characteristics and the natural average inferiority which flows therefrom. He had this great quote about it. "Whatever else man in general may have on his conscience, no reasonable reproach lies to his score as regards his treatment of women. The patience, forbearance, and kindliness with which from Socrates downward men as a rule have encountered the whims, the tempers, and the tantrums of their often unworthy womankind is indeed a marvel, but it is a still greater marvel that modern feminism in this, as in other things, should have succeeded in hocusing public opinion into the delusion that the exact opposite of the truth represents the real state of the case. This, however, is a marvel which runs through the history of the controversial exploits of the whole feminist movement." I find it hard to disagree with him. The whole feminist game is making you look over there and don't look at what I have behind my back, and then the next day it's gonna be, look at this thing behind my back and don't look at the thing over there, because it's now in their best interest to switch it around depending on what they're talking about. To further discuss the gynocentric theory put forth by Lester F. Ward, which I mentioned in the previous video, I'm sure anyone who's familiar with men's rights advocacy will be familiar with his work, but to recap, the gynocentric theory is the supreme importance of the female in the scheme of humanity and nature generally. So even though reproduction and sex are distinct, in the popular mind, any creature which brings forth offspring is instinctively classed as female. Lester Ward presents the idea that the female is the fertile sex. Whatever is fertile is looked at as female. Life begins with a female organism in different forms of sexual reproduction, from fission to parthenogenesis. The female can be said to exist alone and perform all the functions of life, including including reproduction. Life begins as female, and he says asexual creatures are female, and that the male is simply and solely a fertilizer, and that through female sexual selection, the male develops into an independent organism and gets superior size and strength. And then he's able to enslave and oppress women. Essentially, that she is, quote, crushed by a Frankenstein of her own creation. So then you get this system of androcracy, where men rule and dominate, and women are reduced to breeders and servants. But Lester Ward says that the last two centuries have shown movement toward women's emancipation and equality between the sexes. And Bax basically says, okay, even if I go along with this, the only real reason for this theory is to give a scientific basis for the modern feminist movement and help it along. He says that the theory's fatal admission is that evolution broke down the primacy of the female in favor of the male. That even Lester Ward admits that males are superior. He just says that it's through female sexual selection that they became that way. So if you're asserting that men become superior, then how can you also posit the physical, intellectual, and moral equality of the female sex in human society? He says Ward's theory shows that if man's dominance is the result of the evolutionary process, then this is the, quote, highest product of evolution up to date and a powerful argument for anti-feminism, and that this is an instance of the higher being evolved from the lower, that first it's dependent on the parent, but then it develops, and the creator is now subordinate to what it created. So Bax talks about different conceptions of men and women in terms of sexual function. He cites Otto Weininger in a book called Sex and Character, who says that while men has a sex, woman is a sex. Woman is only sexual, but man is also sexual. That the parts of a man that get sexually excited are localized, and it happens in spurts with intervals of rest, and that his sexual organs are an appendix and he can separate himself mentally from his sexual urges. Whereas for women, their sexual excitement is diffused over the whole body, and the sex element is just part of her whole nature. So therefore, man represents the intellectual, moral, and technical development of humanity, while woman's chief purpose is to procreate and further the race in that respect. Bax says that because men's sexual instinct kind of comes on suddenly and it's a need, not a want, that men need more latitude and flexibility in their sexual behavior. So the conduct expectations for men and women cannot be equal. Although he does think that in a reasonable society of the future, the rules will be relaxed for women. But he says that some of the attitudes towards female behavior that exist in his time came about because of economic questions like inheritance, i.e. dealing with bastard children. And so to treat men like women as far as expectations for sexual behavior would be bad for the health and well-being of the community. He cites Dr. Henry Maudsley, who says sex lies deeper than culture, that the differences between men and women are organic. He says woman is, quote, less well-organized, less well-developed. He says women are, quote, shorter, weigh less, have lighter and more fragile bones, a smaller heart, less developed muscles, less lung capacity, and less red-to-white corpuscles in their blood. He says there are differences in the brain, that the woman's brain is smaller than a man's by weight. He then cites some statistics for brain weight that I did not look up. I do know that women are more prone to osteoporosis, so he's probably right about the bones. We do generally weigh less and are generally shorter, so got some things right. He says the frontal lobes are less developed than the occipital lobes in women, but the reverse is true in men. He says women are essentially servants to their childbearing and lactation functions. In my experience and from a lot of the science that I've studied, it's certainly true that women's cognition is much more heavily tied to their hormonal cycle, which is tied to their reproductive organs. And in the past, people used to say, hey, let's give you a hysterectomy just to be safe. And now the science has changed where it's more of a last resort because you can't actually just remove the reproductive organs like there's some module for women and there won't be any consequences. They're there for a reason and they are integrated into the entire functioning of the woman as a whole. They're not just necessary once a month to release an egg. They do affect women's cognition, their energy levels, etc. So Bax says that feminists ignore the physiological differences between the sexes. Bax also spends a good amount of time discussing hysteria, and this is a topic that's come up in almost all the feminist books that I've read so far. He describes it as a group of pathological mental conditions that the female sex experiences connected to constitutional disturbances of the nervous system. It was thought to be a disease of the uterus until the mid-19th century. He describes women experiencing hysteria as having attacks that come with the desire to commit violent acts, that they would tear up clothes and break windows. It was an uncontrollable impulse that would come on all of a sudden with no warning. And so there's a question as to what is the woman's responsibility for her actions under these conditions. He says women with hysteria also crave attention. They'll tell everyone their problems to get sympathy. He cites one doctor, Thomas Buzzard, who says their emotions are easily excited and can't be controlled. It seems to be this like heightened femininity uncontrolled by the higher nervous centers. He says women with hysteria are also prone to deception and dishonesty. This doctor says the symptoms are caused by, quote, impairment of the highly complex nervous processes which form the physiological side of the moral faculties, and that childless women are more vulnerable and they're also nymphomaniacs, and the best cure is a happy marriage. Also, that hysteria is hereditary. Bax says feminists will point out that men can also suffer from hysteria, but that there is a hysteria masculina and hysteria feminina, according to doctors, which is not the same, and that we shouldn't view this medically. He describes hysteria as, quote, certain pathological mental symptoms in women open to everybody's observation and denied by no one unprejudiced by feminist views. He says that any man can see these symptoms in a quarter to a third of women that he's known personally. It's just common sense. Everyone can see it. And, quote, it is for nothing that women and children have always been classed together, that this is a view only challenged by feminists. Bax points out the absence of female genius throughout history and that there are very few women with a high degree of talent. He says this shows the inferiority of the average woman compared to the average man. He says that feminists will sometimes acknowledge this, but they will say it's because women were oppressed in the past. But he points out that heredity could not solely go through the female line. That is to say, even if your mother was oppressed, your father wasn't. So if they're positing that somehow oppression trickles down through the genetic line, and that is why women have some inferiority to men on average, that would be mitigated by the genetic inheritance from her father, who was not oppressed. Bax raises the question of biology when it comes to political feminism's demands. He says modern feminists will say that excluding women from the franchise is logically incompatible with the idea of universal suffrage in the modern idea of democracy. But Bax says that demands to extend suffrage have been based on removing class, race, and wealth barriers. Social barriers, yes, but not barriers based on deep underlying organic difference, that is to say, biological difference. He says one must ask if the biological difference involves intellectual and moral differences, and if they exist, do those differences involve general inferiority or at least render the female sex unfit to exercise political functions? Should women be allowed to vote? That's what he's asking. It's a question I've asked myself many a time. Whether or not hysteria is a real thing, it's certainly true that women are more susceptible to mental health issues related to their hormones. Hormonal imbalances can be the cause of anxiety, depression, irrational rage, general irritability, and much more. Now, I won't necessarily say that I don't think that women should have the vote, though I do question it a lot. Because, for example, when women got the vote, they didn't have to shoulder the same duties and responsibilities that men did. I think that women should have the vote if it comes with the same responsibilities that it does for men. I don't support the existence of the draft, but because it does exist, I think women should be subject to it also. I think that the law should equally apply to men and women, not just in how it's written, but in its administration. The only question is, can that ever be achieved? Is it fair to allow all women to have the ability to vote just because some women, like me, actually want the equal administration of the law, but a lot of women do not, whether explicitly or more subconsciously. They may think they're totally for equality, but when push comes to shove, actually they don't. They're fine with having all the same rights and privileges with none of the responsibilities. In any event, the situation is that the administration of the law is not currently equal. Men are subject to the draft, women are not. The court system is biased against men and in favor of women. It's a fucked up world we live in, and unfortunately I don't see any signs of it changing. But I throw my voice into the wind anyway because it makes me feel a little bit better. So that was just some extra ideas from the book. There's even more. This was just a selection. Again, I highly recommend reading it if you're interested in that sort of thing. But if not, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions about the book, about my opinions on the ideas presented in the book, please let me know. You can leave me a comment, send me an email, DM me on Twitter, whatever you like. And stay tuned for the next video, where I will discuss female criminals as discussed in The Fraud of Feminism. Thank you for watching. If you liked this video, please give it a like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe, and I hope to have more content for you very soon.